In-ray Fall Line Tree Service, Inc. Galen Gentry appearing for appellant. Ethan Bernberg appearing for appellees.
Gentry, do you wish to reserve some time?
I do. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes, please.
Okay, thank you. Minutes.
Good morning, Your Honors. Galen Gentry appearing for appellant, Fall Line Tree Service, Inc. I guess as a housekeeping matter, since the two appeals that are at issue here involve basically the same issues, just with slightly different burdens of proof, I'm just going to argue them together. Again, that would probably be the most efficient way.
I mean, I agree. It's a sort of six of one, half dozen of the other in terms of the issues.
Right. Okay, so diving in, the fundamental issue on appeal is this. Should appellant be required to continue incurring damages from appellee's fraud through further overpayment for assets purchased from appellees?
Well, and let me just stop you right there. So he came up with an amount of damages, right?
Correct.
He made a specific finding of a specific number.
Correct.
And you've collected that number.
Correct.
So how are you continuing to incur damages?
Well, we would continue to incur damages if we have to keep, or if appellant has to keep making payments to appellees on these promissory notes that were the integral part of the underlying fraudulent transactions.
So you disagree with his factual finding as to the amount of damages?
Do not disagree as to the factual finding on the amount of damages. We disagree as to how he dealt with the causes of action requesting disallowance of the proofs of claim.
Well, let me just say, I don't think there's any dispute that what I'm going to call the business note and the proof of claim based on the business note should be gone. And that may be something that ministerial, we could even have, you know, handle at this level, because I'll ask your opposing Mr. Burke. I don't think he disagrees. So that note's gone.
Right.
There's a balance left. It's the full balance on the, what I'll call the inventory note, but that's only because you levy and you've already recovered your damages. If it had you offset, it would be substantially smaller. So we're really talking about, end of the day, $100,000 and change, right?
Approximately that. That's correct.
So tell me the math that gets me to where that should go away too, given his finding that damages were in a specific amount.
Right, and the way the damages were calculated, they were calculated based on the out-of-pocket loss rule, which is the way that damages are calculated for fraud under California law. And they were calculated that way because my client, appellant, Fall Line Tree Service, Inc., had already paid about $110,000 more than the fair market value of the assets that they acquired from appellees. So this is not a case of, you know, there's just a promissory note out there that we're trying to disallow. This is amounts that they had already overpaid. So
he,
we have that.
Walk me through, because he didn't find, that suggests the damages should have been, you're saying you don't agree with the damages number. This is the problem. Let me freely admit, this is not a crystal clear record in terms of what he did, but there are a few things that are lined out in red, and one is damages are this. It's clear from his findings that he assumed that the notes would remain outstanding for some amount, because he said you can offset it, right?
Right, but I think we run into this problem where the doctrine of offset ends up with this kind of awkwardness when it's combined with the out-of-pocket loss rule, and we also have remaining purported outstanding indebtedness from the fraudulent transactions. So if the appellant had already overpaid, that is, they had already paid more than the fair market value of the assets,
there's
no
finding that they'd already paid it as opposed to the finding that face value. $10,000, and then he added the consequential damages from the fact that they had to go to hard money lenders.
But the finding,
did he make that finding?
He did make that finding that they had already overpaid by $110,000, and that's because they had paid about $335,000 to appellees already.
Did he say that they paid that, or that that was the value of what they promised to pay?
No, he did say that they paid that, and that was that there was evidence for that on the record. It was established at trial, and it was undisputed by appellees. They did not argue against having already received that approximately $335,000 amount from appellant. The issue comes in.
$35,000. You've got a couple of requests for admission that are conceded. One was that the inventory was overpaid. They conceded by $100,000, right?
Correct.
And then there was also a determination on the business note that there was a much smaller amount that they didn't get an appraisal. So that was a $270,000 note, but the appraisal, whatever, you were never suggesting that they overpaid on that note the full balance, correct? That wasn't in your request for admission.
No, the request for admissions were submitted early in the case, and they don't necessarily cover the full scope of the damages that that my client had suffered.
That was the basis for some of the awards, aren't they?
For some of it, yeah, but the finding that that the trial court made as to the value of the business was that it was worth $225,000, and that was based on the testimony by the business broker who had reviewed.
And you're saying he included the inventory in that? The business broker correct included the inventory in that appraisal, did she?
She did, and that's in the testimony that the business broker had provided appellees an opinion of value on the business that included inventory, and that opinion was that it was worth $225,000.
All right. So, is it necessary? Where did he find that all the overpayment was the result of fraud?
I think it's in his findings of fact and conclusions of law. I could try to direct you particularly to the
because I'm having a problem with. You know, what he clearly found, which is this set amount of damages, and that set amount of damages, there's two things that I think you're arguing that I'm having trouble with. One, that he clearly found that 110 was additional, you know, that they'd already paid everything or they'd already overpaid that. I don't see that finding crisply made. And then the second problem is I don't see let's start with that one. Where is that?
Sure. So at the bottom of page 24 of the findings of fact and conclusions of law, and that's appellant's appendix 975, the sentence reads, and section 334 informs the analysis and leads me to conclude that the difference in the actual value of the assets purchased and the amount already paid is $110,000.
Okay, so you're saying that having said that, what he said that his other statements about you can offset his other statements that this is the amount of damages valued it at that amount, and that's what we have to.
That's correct. Did he value the business assets at $225,000 in accordance with the business broker's testimony? And he found that $110,000 had already been paid, and he awarded that amount plus the $13,324 or so.
And to have that result, don't we necessarily also have to conclude that he determined that all the overpayment?
Correct. That's 100% correct. What's that? That all of the overpayment was the result of fraud? I think the fact that his sentence refers to section 334, 3343.
That's the civil code, right?
Right, the civil code.
So you're backing into it that way.
Yeah. Right, it's California Civil Code section 3343 informs the analysis and leads Judge Klein to conclude that the difference in the actual value of the assets purchased and the amount already paid is $110,000. So he's not differentiating, you know, within that amount, whether, you know, $70,000 of it was incurred for some other reason or if it was based on the actual value of the assets. I think he found that the value of the assets was $225,000 They had already paid $335,000. Therefore, their out-of-pocket losses already incurred were $110,000 and then plus the approximately $13,000. So we get to a point where the fraud damages make my client whole. They make appellant whole, basically. They bring them back to kind of square one in terms of having received back what they had overpaid for those assets. And that leaves us with the additional problem of these remaining promissory notes, where appellees are still trying to collect money for those assets where they had induced appellant to overpay for them. And the only logical conclusion is that those promissory notes need to be disallowed in their entirety as to any remaining amounts, because there is no logical reason, whether it's due to, you know, appellee's unclean hands or due to a failure of consideration or due to kind of a modified application of the set-off rule, there is no logical basis to allow appellees to continue collecting money when the trial judge already ruled that appellant had overpaid for those assets. I would, thank you.
All right. All right, Mr. Bernberg.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. My name is Ethan Bernberg, and I represent the three appellees listed in this matter. Our brief described what our view of Judge Klein's ruling was and why it was correct. He allowed the inventory proof of claim in the amount that it was stated, the $246,000 number. I think Judge Taylor's questions are directly on point with regards to some of the evidentiary issues that the appellants have. And I won't go over all of my brief, but I want to hit a few salient points and also address a few evidentiary issues and areas that were admitted to the lower court of what Judge Klein relied on to reach his conclusion. And I think ultimately, based on what I've heard from appellant's argument today, there's two separate parts of this sale transaction. And I think that's where maybe the disconnect is, or at least in our view, that's definitely where it is. Judge Klein sees the inventory part of the sale transaction, which went through escrow. It was helped by the broker, Katrina Lofton, and the parties went item by item with the inventory to count it before closing. Now, then there's the second part, which is the goodwill, the fixtures, the furniture, point of sale system, all the other things you need to do to run a ski shop. And these two parts have very different analysis. The business broker helps with the inventory side, pushes it through escrow and receives a commission for that. And the parties agree that $396,849 of inventory was sold that day. And then the business broker argues that the purchase price should only be $225,000. Well, Judge Klein weighs that evidence. And again, the business broker says that she's not an appraiser. She does not have qualifications as an expert. She's essentially a person with personal knowledge providing lay testimony. Judge Klein says, okay, I have evidence of $335,000 of payments. I see that this is worth $225,000 for the goodwill, the fixtures, and the fortunes. And I'm going to do math here. $110,000 of damages. As Your Honors have pointed out, there's another $13,000 of hard lender damages. So we get to that amount of $123,000 and change. And then Judge Klein says, I'm going to offset that from the allowed proof of claim number four for the inventory. Because all of the evidence, both by testimony and in documents, states that that inventory was sold on that day. And therefore, it's allowed, but it's subject to offset. And how do we know that? Well, first off, Ms. Nichols, the Fall Lines principal, testifies that she always knew there was two separate transactions. There was the goodwill, the fixtures, and the furniture, and then there was the inventory that went through escrow. She testifies that she made an item-by-item count of all the inventory. She put it on a spreadsheet in her computer, and then the parties agreed that it was worth $396,849. They paid $10,000 at closing, and that led to the $386,000 promissory note that supports the inventory proof of claim. But two more things happen right after that closing. First, Fall Line sells that inventory and grosses over $1 million during 2018. The closings in May of 2018, by the end of that year, they've grossed over $1 million with the inventory and the other items that they purchased. And that's Appellate Appendix 418 is their tax return. Ms. Nicholas' testimony on Appellate Appendix 635 says that they made over $1 million. And in her view, that was $150,000 to $200,000 more than the appellees had ever made when they operated that business.
Well, can I ask you a stupid question? That, with respect solely to the inventory that was purchased on the day of the purchase, not with respect to anything that might have been purchased afterward, was that reckoning actually done? The tax return wouldn't tell you that.
When you say reckoning, are you saying reconciliation of some nature?
Well, no, there's a certain amount that's sold on a closing day, right? I mean, I forget what day of the, you know, where that is in the calendar year, but are you assuming that they didn't buy anything else in the meantime? So whatever they generated had to do only with that inventory? That doesn't sound right to me.
Right. No, great question.
Your tax return never would have told you that, right?
Well, I'm not sure about the attachment, but
the findings, but that just doesn't sound right.
Correct. No, I understand the concept. And what happened is...
Maybe it doesn't matter.
I would like to answer the question, Your Honor, because I think it does provide some color. I'm sorry. I didn't know if there was another question from the panel.
Yeah.
Go ahead and answer his question.
So it's an important question. It's an important fact that we find here in the transcript. The inventory escrow, again, the separate portion of that sale transaction, Ms. Katrina Lofton helps with it and tells both parties, this is her testimony, you need to find a purchase price so I can open escrow. So both parties say, let's call it $500,000. And they execute an original purchase agreement, which is in the appendix, I believe it's 363. And that states that the purchase price for the inventory is about $500,000. It's a guess that the parties think might happen because they're going to reconcile it before actual closing. Paragraph 4 of that original purchase agreement even says it could be anywhere from 250 to 500. So then time moves on, and on April 30th, 2018, right before that May closing, they do the item-by-item inventory, they do the reconciliation of what was purchased, and then they sign what is known as the joint inventory statement by both parties, stating the amount of the inventory was $396,849. So I don't think after that, at least to my knowledge, Your Honor, the record and the attachments don't display what would happen after that, except that Fall Line received all that inventory and then sold it. And that's from the gross receipts.
So my only point is they probably sold it and something else if you're talking about an end of the year result. That's my only point.
I apologize if I misunderstood. I would agree.
Yeah, so,
I mean,
so
they didn't.
If we're trying to back into 396 by saying, well, they sold it for $1.2 million, I think the $1.2 million might have resulted from something more than the inventory at closing. That's my only point.
So I agree.
Okay. Your client's bound by the request for permission, though, that where they agreed that the inventory was the price was overstated by $100,000, correct?
Your Honor, I can't contest about Rule 36 and the deemed admissions. I do think, though, the record reflects that Judge Klein tried to take in the testimony, not rely on the request for admissions. I don't believe the record actually reflects him admitting the admissions after the motion, although I think it's inferred that he does rely upon in his finding the facts. So, but I do think Judge Klein was trying to take a fair take at it, realizing that it was a technical failure to respond on behalf of the appellees and wanted to know what the evidence was.
Well, let me back this up. This case was decided, the damages were awarded solely on the basis of fraud, correct?
I believe the amount of the purchase price. I think fraud was embedded in the problems. There's no doubt about that. And in the findings.
The causes of action which led to the damages award weren't, there was a lot in this complaint. It wasn't based on breach of contract, right?
Right. Correct.
It wasn't based on unfair business practices, right?
I believe that was pled as a cause of action, but withdrawn.
Right. So everything that the damages aren't based just on the disparity in the price. The damages are based on the disparity in price to the extent it was caused by fraud or misrepresentation or, you know, omission, whatever. Is that correct?
I believe it's correct, but I also think it's centered on the fact of Ms. Katrina Lofton's testimony of what she believed that other portion of the purchase price should have been and then what was actually paid. So, but there was allegations of fraud, and I do believe Judge Klein found that there were some fraudulent actions that occurred during that time. But I don't think he said, based on the fraud, I'm finding $110,000 of damages. I think the calculation was based on what was paid versus maybe what the, or versus what the Ms. Lofton stated the purchase price was for that portion of the sale transaction. So I think it's important. We talked about the original purchase agreement and about how they worked through the inventory and the escrow. There's also a personal property escrow instructions that state the exact amount of that inventory, the $396,843. Ms. Nichols' testimony, the Appellee's testimony, and Ms. Lofton's testimony all confirmed, and Judge Klon understood, that they had these two separate transactions, and the escrow only concerned the inventory. There was no question about it. But the biggest problem that Judge Klein had was with the what they referred to as the side deal, the $270,000 promissory note. And as Judge Taylor mentioned, we agree, that was disallowed. Proof of Claim 5 is disallowed, but it's separate from the inventory. And Judge Klein saw that they received that inventory, they sold that inventory, they agreed to pay for it, and in fact, for 20 months, after they signed that closing, they made monthly payments. That's how we get to that $246,000 proof of claim that was filed timely and is presumed allowed and evidence under Rule 3001. None of those dollar amounts were ever contested at the trial court because they know they sold that much inventory, Alline received it, and then they paid monthly as they needed to because this was a seller carry transaction. And I think what's also key here is that joint inventory statement. And that's Appellee Appendix 001 that clearly states both parties counted the inventory. I think Judge Klein had the right to and did weigh that evidence. He weighed the evidence that he received from the broker and decided here's how he's going to fashion a remedy. Now,
but do you think the problem here, let's all be, the problem is those findings aren't exactly a model of clarity, correct?
Correct, Your Honor.
So we've got, he says a lot of stuff, and there are a few things that aren't crystal clear. One, for example, is that these are the damages for fraud. I disagree that he didn't say they were fraud. I think he said the 110, and then he says, and there's another 13,000 because they were induced to go to a hard money lender, which I'm finding. And I agree with you that my read, even though it's not clearly stated, is that he was very focused on the 270. He made that note disappear. But he is, as Mr. Jeffrey says, he did do a calculation that is susceptible to sort of zeroing out everything. And does that not induce enough ambiguity that we should send it back and say, sure?
Not in the appellee's view. I think there's substantial evidence showing that the inventory proof of claim was allowed, and that's why the set-off would occur. And when
you think the fact that he talked about set-off meant that necessarily he determined that the inventory claim would have some value beyond the 110?
Yes, Your Honor, because there's two separate transactions, two portions of this transaction, and all the evidence is there. And so what one of the things is you mentioned clarity inside of the findings of facts and conclusions of law. One of the things that is stated that appellant brought up in their reply brief is that the inventory was $150,000 overpriced. That is stated in the findings of facts conclusion of law, but there's no evidence to support that. That's one of those things that just seemed to come up, and then Judge Klein never uses that in any type of damage calculation or trying to fashion a remedy. So there's no evidence for that. That issue wasn't up on appeal. The appellant did not appeal that issue.
If that is the result of a bad business decision versus fraud, who cares?
Fair enough, Your Honor. And I believe that was really the crux of the opinion or the positions for the parties at trial was that a deal is a deal and they had an agreement. And the appellant side was saying, well, this was a fraudulent deal. I do think that was the background or at least the main arguments that were made. But in our view,
let me ask you another question, sort of a cleanup question. We have, we have this motion for reconsideration, which is extremely well taken as to the fact that he didn't state in his final ruling that consistent with his oral ruling that this was an unsecured transaction and then that other note went away. Do you have, it strikes me as bizarre given your agreement that you didn't just stipulate to that, but would you have any opposition to us directing that at the appellate, to requiring that modification at the appellate level?
No, Your Honor.
Remand for that to happen?
Yes. Thank you, Your Honor. No, we would not have opposition to that. And I believe that if there was a remand, it should be, you know, modified and instructed. The disallowance of proof of claim number 5, I think, is there in the record and it's not challenged. I also think, and this was also conceded, there was an argument at the trial level about the avoidance of that security interest. The UCC-1 wasn't filed. It wasn't protected. 544 avoids it. I was not counsel at the trial court level, but my read of the transcript was that it was not even contested. So I don't think those issues at all, and why it wasn't stipulated to, I unfortunately can't speak to, but I can say that the appellees do not have any issue with that type of instructive ruling. But it is our position on the proof of claim, the inventory proof of claim and proof of claim number 4, that it was allowed in the amount that it was filed. It was not challenged. It's subject to set off. Now, since the appellant has collected the full amount, I believe the appellant's position is now it should be unaffected. So I guess that means it's allowed in the amount of $246,000, that amount that was allowed in. I don't know if that's an issue for today, but we believe that the trial court record shows that the inventory proof of claim was allowed and subject to set off. And that's based on the facts and the record below. Almost consistently, whether it was the appellee testifying, the broker testifying, or the appellant testifying. And certainly, the lion's share of all the evidence shows they purchased that inventory, and Judge Klein, in my view, essentially said, you should pay for that. However, they have a confirmed Chapter 11 plan that's going to reduce that unsecured amount by about 41%, so they'll pay that much less, but that's the bankruptcy process. But ultimately, at the end of the day, they should pay for the inventory they received and they sold at a profit. I think that's what Judge Klein's view was, and that's what he ordered. And that's why we believe that aspect of the lower court ruling should be affirmed. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. All right, Mr. Gentry, rebuttal.
Yes, thank you, Your Honors. So I think there are a couple things that my opponent misconstrues from the record. Number one, the notion that Judge Klein had no problem with the inventory promissory note is simply not correct. As I point out in the reply brief that we filed, Judge Klein found in appellant's favor on their promissory fraud cause of action, which was based on that inventory note. And in sum and substance, it was that appellees had made a promise to appellant that they would price the inventory on a sliding scale, but at the very last minute, they reneged on that promise and required that appellant pay full price for it. So again, it is unambiguous in the record that Judge Klein found the inventory note problematic and found that appellees were liable to appellant for that promissory fraud as well. The award was the same as, or it was kind of lumped together with the other fraud causes of action, the fraud by concealment and the fraud by intentional misrepresentation. But I think it is entirely fallacious for for my opponent to represent to the panel here that there was no issue with the inventory promissory note.
Assuming that I agree with you on the point that now fraud damages, okay? So there was a problem with something. And he's disallowed the other note completely. Different reasons that we're not even discussing here today because that's not an issue for us. Doesn't he also, in his ruling, contemplate set off, which wouldn't that necessarily, you know, require that the note retain a balance? The set off of 123 is not going to net out that note.
Correct. And I think we disagree with the calculation in that insofar as we read the findings of fact and conclusions of law, it appears that Judge Klein made a finding that the overall value of the assets purchased was $225,000, that appellant had already paid $110,000. And that being the case, there would be no reason for appellant to continue making payments on it. We think that the trial court simply erred in applying in setting off the compensatory damages that were awarded, rather than awarding compensatory damages and disallowing the remaining proofs of claim in their entirety.
Had the motion for reconsideration, and I'm a little unclear on what happened at that point. I know you briefed it. Did he not have? You know, he doesn't even mention your cleanup changes at all. So, which is, but it appeared that he didn't have something in front of him at the time. Can you tell us what happened on the motion for reconsideration, where you made these same arguments to him, and he didn't change anything?
Right. That's a good question. I think what had happened, there was a power outage near the bankruptcy courthouse here in Sacramento. And I think at that point, he was still consistent with the remote procedures. He was taking the hearing remotely from perhaps his residence. And he may not have had access to the docket on PACER to actually look at the filings. So that may explain why those corrections were not made at that time. But otherwise, I can only speculate.
Reformation at the appellate level, obviously, because you want that to happen.
That's correct.
If we can find a way to do that.
That's correct. But I would urge the panel to direct the full disallowance of the two proofs of claim, given that the findings, we believe, unambiguously reflect that appellant had already overpaid for those assets.
All right. Thank you very much for your good arguments. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honors.